As we all know, America is a complex patchwork of varying viewpoints and perspectives that can differ from state to state or sometimes on the very same side of the street. 2 weeks ago, our Martha Raddatz set out on a trip across the country to get a sense of what's on the minds of voters with election less than 7 weeks away. Tonight, the final leg of Martha's journey, a view from the South and two traditionally red states.
We set out on a cross-country drive to talk to voters, stopping in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Missouri, and Colorado. Moving from the endless fields of the Midwest onto the red rocks of the Southwest, where the massive Navajo Nation battles to overcome barriers to voting.
If we can't get our ballots back in time to the county seats, they will not be accepted.
From Arizona, we headed back east through Texas and Georgia, two traditionally Republican strongholds where Democrats hope to compete in 2020. Texas hasn't voted for a Democrat since Jimmy Carter. Donald Trump won here in 2016 by 9 points. But its demographics are changing, and the president and Joe Biden are in a statistical tie in the latest polls. To carry Texas, the former vice president will need voters like Joanna Contreras, a 22-year-old college student in the Dallas suburbs. She was fired up to vote for Hillary Clinton, and when Clinton lost...
I remember, like, not going to school the next day because I was, like, it was, like, almost the worst heartbreak I think I've ever felt.
You're supporting Biden this time?
Yes.
Would you say you're an enthusiastic supporter of Biden?
I actually wouldn't say that. I mean, I think we have a lot of similarities, ideological, but I think I'm probably a bit more progressive.
Motivating voters like Joanna has worried some in Biden's camp, but there is another factor that may drive Democrats to the polls.
He's not Trump, so.
So would you say your vote is more for a vote against Donald Trump rather than for Joe Biden?
Yeah, I would say so.
Mont Parrish is a diehard Republican, and while he does not endorse everything Donald Trump does or says, he is sticking with him.
He's not always polished and pretty, and we don't necessarily understand everything he says or why he says some of the things he says, but he's doing his job. He's done what he said he's going to do.
Parrish does not follow every twist and turn of Washington politics. He says he's an issues voter, anti-abortion and pro-Second Amendment, and he trusts Trump with the economy.
I think he stands for what I believe is right, things that are important to me and my family.
So important are some of those issues that Trump supports. Jonathan Gaspard not only changed his mind about Trump, he is wholly on board.
I would never say I was never Trumper, but I was definitely not on the Trump train, and I was very, very critical of him.
Gaspard, a small business owner in Dallas, active in local Republican politics, voted for independent Evan McMullen in 2016. Skeptical of Trump's conservative credentials then, or that he would get anything done.
You've changed your mind about Donald Trump.
Yes. Because track record, rhetoric aside, you put Twitter accounts aside, you put actual record. What has he done for the economy, for what's important to me, like the pro-life thing? He's won me. And I want 4 more years of that.
And you've read about the numbers of lies that are on the record, or you've seen the Twitter account, or you've seen how he calls people names.
Yeah, which I'm not a fan of.
Does that not matter anymore?
No, it matters. I wish he would say things differently, but he executes the position in a way that I'm like, I would prefer over Joe Biden 100%.
And even on the coronavirus, voters like Gaspard are giving Trump high marks.
I have no problem with his response to COVID, and I actually, I take exception to some of the criticism of his handling of it.
Gaspard may have been won over by the president, but not Carl Wilde.
If he had taken a more aggressive stance on COVID like he was told to do instead of downplaying the seriousness of it, we might not be looking at, you know, so many Americans who had died of the disease at this point.
Carl Wilde is a U.S. Army veteran who braved intense combat in Iraq. He and his wife now run their small businesses east of Dallas in Honey Grove, Texas, a town that seems a throwback to the 50s. Once an ardent Trump fan.
I thought he was the change that America truly needed at that point. I thought he was going to be our savior. And as it turned out, I couldn't have been further from it.
Wilde says he can't look past the president's behavior.
He's just not a leader. He's not a leader. He doesn't act like a leader needs to act. You can't respect that man.
His mind was made up even before the Atlantic magazine report alleging that Trump called fallen veterans suckers and losers. Wilde says even if you can't say for certain those quotes are accurate, he certainly believes they could be.
The fact of the matter is, you can believe that he made those comments. And you should never have a president that you could believe would talk down about his own military and about military veterans and gentlemen who died fighting for their country.
But Wilde does not want either Trump or Biden. He doesn't know how he will cast his vote. From Texas, we continued our journey to Georgia, where it is not just who to vote for, but how that vote will be cast and counted. Charges of voter suppression were ringing out loudly here in Georgia in 2018 after a very close governor's race. And in 2020, those charges are ringing out again. While Trump won Georgia by 5 points in 2016, the race is considered competitive this fall, making voter turnout key. And the primaries here in June, a warning sign, an election marred by long lines and problems with voting machines.
Oh, my gosh, it was a nightmare.
Irene Kamara is a retiree in the Atlanta suburbs, fearful of the coronavirus.
A lot of people died in vain. And like I said, I'm afraid to come out of my house.
But she was determined to vote. When her mail-in ballot for the Democratic primary didn't show up and her nearby polling place was shut down, she drove to one further away.
I got to the polling place at 9 o'clock in the morning. I got to the voting door at 4 p.m. Once I got to the door, I had to wait because they would let two people in at a time. It was a nightmare.
You know there have been charges of voter suppression. Do you think that's the case?
Exactly. Exactly. Brian Kemp stole that election from Stacey Abrams.
Do you think African Americans are targeted?
100%.
In downtown Atlanta, Marnia Mitchell faced many of the same issues with voting in the primaries.
It was despicable and it was disgusting. This is 2020. We're supposed to be the greatest country on this planet, and yet this is what some of our American citizens have to go through. I'd like to think we're an honest country and an honest nation, but I'm not ignorant that there are undercurrents of other motives going on.
Mitchell wouldn't say who she's voting for in the fall, instead wanting to stress the importance of exercising the right to vote and the difference it can make. Nearly 40% of Americans stayed home in the last two presidential elections, including a 7-point drop among black voters between 2012 and 2016.
You think you're not counted in, you think it doesn't matter. It does matter. Get up and go and vote.
After 5,700 miles and dozens of voter interviews, that's a message every American should take to heart. Reporting from across America, I'm Martha Raddatz for ABC News Live.
Our thanks to Martha on the road for us.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.